It's nice to be here. Thanks for the opportunity to talk. Steve's a hard act to follow, the best of times. I'm also going to plead that I've just returned from 8 flights, 10 airports, and 8 days of talking about crocodiles in Argentina. Got back on Sunday night around midnight, so I'm a little tired, and I'm afraid my slides, I'm going to lead myself by the nose through them with the aid of plenty of text, because I can't trust my memory right now. It's a very interesting conference because crocodiles get themselves into all sorts of pickles in many countries, but the focus of our specialist group has very much been, as in many conservation arenas, has been impact. So if you go and look at the Crocodile Specialist Group website and you look for the advice we offer, it's pretty much about crocodiles biting people. But if you listen to the talks at the conference, you realize that there were a lot of conflicts, and some of the most serious conflicts over crocodiles were not about crocodiles biting people. They were about the fact that one of our major solutions to conflict is to make crocodiles economically valuable, something that was pioneered in Zim, in Africa anyway. Problems now are quite different. First of all, being successful in conservation means you have lots of crocodiles and they stop to bite people, as they're doing in Zim. The problems are also entirely different because we are raising crocodiles in industrial scale in farms. And now we have conflicts over animal rights, well-being, how those animals are being kept. These are very different kinds of conflicts. So we need to get, certainly in the planet crocodile, we need to get quite a lot smarter about how we deal with these range of conflicts which involve crocodiles but are not necessarily about the impacts of crocodiles on us. It's fundamentally what I'm going to talk about, something I'm struggling with myself and struggling with in the literature. So this talk isn't quite Mein Kampf, but it kind of is my struggle. I started out, I grew up with crocodiles. My father did a lot of work on crocodile behavior and conservation up on the border of Mozambique and South Africa. We used to go out and catch crocodiles that were eating people's livestock and occasionally them. As a boy, even I saw the damage they can do to people. So inevitably, if you study crocodiles, you do end up having to deal with this, and you try and figure out how to do that. And what I think one of the things we need to talk about is there's a kind of resistance to dealing with the tools we need to do this. Not so much the tools. There are some tools that seem relatively easy to understand, that we can mobilize to understand this stuff. Questionnaires, stuff we can go out, do surveys, model it, analyze it statistically. There's not a lot of engagement with the concepts that have developed, that have informed these toolboxes. And that's, I think, something we need to struggle with a bit more. And it's hard to talk about this stuff because actually people will say, we don't have time for this stuff. It's ivory tower. We've got to get down and save these guys. We've got to find out why people are doing it and fix it. So I'm going to talk about why we should engage a bit. So it's a bit more fiddly. I'm going to talk a little bit about my methods. And I think there's some reasons why people don't want to get bogged down in talking about some of these. One of the challenges is it's messy. You go into the social sciences and you say, right, okay, right, I'm going to understand behavior. Well, good luck. So if you want to talk about attitudes and behavior, you need a theory of behavior, but there isn't just one. There are loads. That's a challenge. Something Steve mentioned and something that I worry about is if you link it to this cultural relativism, and there's certainly a big moment in conservation in the 80s and the 90s where people fell out and said wilderness is all in your mind, and there's a lot of argument about these things. Some people say, no, actually there is wilderness. It's out there, it's outside of us. Not everything is constructed. Other people, we have big fights about this. It makes social science theories appear daunting, and it's just what Steve was saying. There's this worry that you say, well, if we can engage with this stuff, do we end up just having to say everyone's point of view is okay, because that's not going to work. Anecdotes, here's another problem. Kinds of evidence. Anecdotes, old school natural history perhaps, can provide important evidence about particular behavior, particular of individuals, things translocated lines do that natural lines are not supposed to do. Significant, I'll say a bit more about this later. But how do you, is this real science? If you can't scale it up, do we pay attention to the stuff, or is this a kind of evidence that we just don't talk about? And obviously there's the ethical implications. We want to change people's behavior. That's quite a profound thing to do. To go in somewhere and say, actually, you know, you guys have been doing this and you guys think this way. Well, you're wrong. I don't think you should do that, is kind of what you're saying. And if you think about it, in terms of most destructive world views, in terms of environmental impacts on the planet, that's pretty much a Western European point of view. If you want to just quantify deforestation and all the rest of it. So we should be careful about exporting our points of view. We need to think it through. And I just think so. There's a kind of business studies route. You can go and buy off the peg. This is the box. You take it out. This is how you do the survey. It'll tell you what you need to do. And dodging that underlying conceptual stuff, I do think it's counterproductive. I do think it's worth trying to engage with. And we don't have to invent this stuff. There are a bunch of fields out there who've been working on this stuff for a long time. And so we need to engage with it. So that's the overview. So we have a pretty good toolkit for the practical mitigation of impacts. There are a lot of strategies. A paper just came out that Steve was on, surveying a range of strategies, and it's pretty impressive. We don't have such good toolkits for tackling the underlying social and cultural dimensions of those, and that's something well recognized by people, certainly here at Wild Crew. There's been a lot of research over the past decade or so using quantitative approaches, trying to find the roots of problematic human behavior, and certainly the tendency has been to take familiar methods, and these are quantitative social science, economics, because they're pretty analogous to the methods that we use already. So what do? You try and find the key socioeconomic variables influencing the negative behavior. You explore the relationships between those variables. And really, almost every thesis that does social ecological work and that looks at conflicts will be doing surveys, questionnaire surveys, gathering data, and that's good. That's pretty much mostly what we've been doing. At first, these were pretty unsophisticated. Increasingly, people are starting to use psychological models to explain human behavior. So these papers you'll be familiar with. And this is really important. If you want to change behavior, if you're going to study attitudes, you need to know how that articulates with behavior. If you don't have a model for doing that, you have found out something about attitudes which has no relationship with actually the behavior that you're going to change. You need and you need to understand the relationship of all the other factors which might prevent attitudes from changing behavior. So people are repeatedly finding that the attitudes that shape problematic behavior are difficult to predict in the usual way. You go into your questionnaire and you just articulate gender, age, livelihood. Actually, I mean, Alex has done these big studies of jaguars. those kind of breakdowns aren't always very helpful at predicting what people do, right? All their behaviors. There are other things going on that influence people's behaviors. And obviously, as Alex has also written, attitudes aren't always good predictors of behavior. Some people have great attitudes towards jaguars. They think jaguars are amazing. And they kill them. Because you're quite a man if you kill a jaguar. It's an impressive beast. So good attitude, bad behavior. Bad attitude, don't like jaguars, scared of jaguars, don't kill jaguars. Bad attitude, good behavior. It's a mess. So Alex has written, again, I'm quoting her a lot today for some reason. Attitudes are shaped by all these things. So Andy has written about some of these other factors that are coming into play, things like history, things like culture. David's written about all these other reasons why species are persecuted. Why do we, on the other side, preserve them? For all these reasons. Aesthetic reasons, symbolic, spiritual, ethical, utilitarian. They're important as cultural icons. So there are all these other dimensions that are important when it comes to understanding how people are behaving towards these animals that we care about, that we wish to persist. Cairns Skerdal, I'm sure you know this paper, they did this big analysis of things that influence attitudes, and they found something very interesting. Actually, it seems, from the reviewed literature, intangible costs were the most important category, not the direct impacts. Actually, it was fear, opportunity costs, all sorts of other things going on that even if the crocodile wasn't attacking you, the stress of probably or possibly being attacked by a crocodile, the opportunity cost of walking 20 miles around and crossing the bridge, all of those things influence people. Retaliatory persecution of animals often not motivated by the direct impact. So these are findings from the literature. Again, this cultural and social perceptions. So what do we do? So one response to this has been what Amy and others have done. Study the actual impacts alongside the perceptions of the impacts. And then essentially try and show people that they're wrong. This is what people think is going on. This is what's really going on. And why, and the need to do this is because these imprecise linkages between reality and perception render many biologically based conservation actions relevant. So you've done the research, you find out what's really going on with lions and crocodiles, but the problem is it's rendered partly irrelevant because people have a completely different idea of what's going on. So how do we get at this stuff? Can we do this? Can we prove, really, that people are mistaken in their beliefs, persuade them with the evidence that they're wrong? Well, we certainly should try. Unfortunately, a lot of recent research, particularly, as we know, after recent elections in the United States and here, I'm not going to get sidetracked into Brexit, shows people are unlikely to be persuaded to change their opinions. David's talked about the importance of feelings in influencing people's responses to big cats. It's been neglected in conservation studies because we don't study the irrational. It's not what science tends to do. And it's hard to do. He cites Spencer's epithet, opinion is ultimately determined by feelings and not by the intellect. People are not it's rational. You can see here. But it's more of the science. There's no swimming crocodiles and hippopotamus. I have about 7 or 8 crocodile attacks recorded here, St. Lucia Estuary. 5 of them fatal. There you go. So I think current approaches to understanding and changing behavior tend to assume behavior is essentially rational. are we going to persuade people with showing them what's really going on? But as I think many people who've worked in these situations have found, and as really interestingly psychologists working on trauma have been saying, this is not the case, especially when it comes to traumatic events or difficult things going on around some of these symbolically important things. Emotion, Cecil the Lion, as you all know, there was an awful lot of emotion swirling around that incident. And these kinds of things have the capacity to go viral. They can shape responses regardless of whether these stories roughshod over the inconvenient facts. So it's a very interesting reactions from Zimbabweans about this. How come you guys care about this darn line and look what's been happening to us? You know, all kinds of different ways, different responses to this. People responded and massively supported Wild Crew's actions, and then thought, but wait a minute, you guys aren't trying to preserve every single lion, but you guys say that it's okay to kill some lions. Oh my goodness. No idea what's going on the ground, but massively influenced by their feelings towards an animal they've never encountered on the wild. So obviously I'm not saying education is a waste of time or shouldn't be based on sound science. A lot of what I do is just that. So I'm doing my posters and booklets, and just been in Zululand doing outreach, I should say KwaZulu-Natal, and Swaziland doing outreach with local people, but also trying to figure out what they know and what they think about what these animals are doing and what they mean in their lives. But what I am suggesting is that the facts and the good science and what's going on in these places seems to be not sufficient if we're trying to address some of these problematic scenarios. And particularly, what do we do about culture? What do we do about this thing? This kind of residue that we're not really getting at with the surveys and the questionnaires. How do we get a handle on this slippery thing? Now this is probably unfair, and I've been looking at this very narrowly in terms of crocodiles biting people mostly. But in terms of human conflict literature, the psychological studies on fear and tolerance are useful, but not for looking at culture. Right, so they're trying to model causes of behavior, measure variables, test relationships. That's not what they do. So ethnographic approaches seem to be the most fertile, I have to say that, because Kate Teal's over there. There's some very interesting work here in terms of how we get at this kind of stuff. And one of the things that, so there's a study by Goldman et al. On lions. I always feel slightly nervous when I talk about anything to do with lions, because I'm sure present company know all sorts of things about possibly those lions and possibly those researchers that I don't, but nevertheless, they made an interesting observation, I think. That current approaches are, one issue is this framing along our Western analytical categories. And that does mean we can miss a lot of some of the ambivalent ways local people think of. I mean, you guys will know this. I know Amy's talked about this. People have contradictory ideas within these things that we call communities. Not everyone in a community has the same belief. Some people have traditional beliefs, some people are Christian and don't have any of that stuff going on. So they did the study of the Maasai, they did interviews, participant observation. These are classic ethnological approaches. They collected stories about lions. The important point about the research and the stuff they were capturing, I think, is that whether they convey true events or not, that's not the important thing. It's not saying, oh, this is what these guys think and it's wrong and we need to fix it. It's really trying to figure out what the way they talk about lions tells you about their kind of moral understanding, their values, and their explanations for how they interact with lions. Should go without saying, anthropology's been around a long time. They've been figuring this stuff out. They have established ways of working in the field, of recording field data. They have, it's variable, of course, they're different kinds of anthropologists, but there's a smorgasbord of stuff out there. They have ethical standards for field work in particular, which are important. And we need to learn from them, and we need to work ideally with them if we're trying to capture this kind of stuff, because we don't really have the tools to do that. Ethnography is hard. You know, Gary Marvin's got a great phrase, ethnography is informed hanging out. Which means, one thing it means is, you've got to have a lot of time. You've got to go live there. You've got to have the language. And you've got to go with the mind prepared with some questions, but you've got to be open to it, to what's going to come. And I'll talk briefly about that. So some limits that I see that I struggle with. Using questionnaires, Likert scales, conceptual models of behavior, those are all things that we do. These are tools that we have and they can be useful. They do mean that we're kind of determining what we're going to get back, right? We've gone in there deciding on the questions that we're going to ask, which means there are also going to be things which haven't occurred to us which we're not going to get told. If you don't ask the question, you're not going to get told. People in interviews kind of figure out what you're interested in, who you are. To some extent, they'll tell you stuff. There's other stuff they're not going to tell you about the supernatural lion or something. They think, oh, he doesn't want to know about that. Some of them just don't go there. So there is an amount, there is an issue with filtering out things that we should probably, would be useful to know. I do all my, collect all my crocodile data and I try and get useful patterns out of it, and it's really useful. Who's being attacked? What age groups? Where? What were they doing? Where are the hot spots? But at the same time, when I do that, I'm stripping away all the detail, all the particular histories and things that were going on in particular places. So having done that, if I want to inform management, I need to go back into the detail. I need to go back into that particular place and figure out all the kinds of things like culture are filtered out in that process. They're extracted. And obviously, this kind of analysis is inherently reductive. So even people's stories, you capture the story, you code it, you put it, chop it up into units of analysis. What we tend not to do is to put those pieces back together and figure out why people are telling us these stories. What's the function of these stories? I just wanted to say briefly, so this is Sichelo, who I just interviewed in Swaziland in March. He was dragged by a crocodile. She was pulled underwater 5 times. She managed to get hold of some reeds and yells. Some guys came in, grabbed her, and pulled her out. Crocodile came too, wasn't letting go. Fortunately, not a very big crocodile. But this is the kind of detail that we take out when we do our statistical analyses. She's got a very badly fractured wrist. She's lost her hand doesn't work properly anymore. Her parents, her single parent, can either afford school fees or medical. She's in standard equivalent of your final year of school. She's come out of school. I don't think she'll ever go back. There's no money for it. So the consequence of this, which is being dealt with, is from now on for her. Her life has changed by this incident. And she was fine, I mean, relatively, in terms of what happens to people. So in terms of attitudes and stuff, we haven't dealt with her. You know, her attitude and her response and the consequences last longer than our analysis and interest. So I'm going to say a few things about studying people. Some tools that I'm trying to use, there are tools from other disciplines we can use. I think narrative analysis is quite interesting. It's not reductive, it's not chopping up and coding. How do people understand and communicate about these encounters in particular places and contexts? Are we trying to get to those particularities? How do they explain the causality of events? You know, I go down and tell people, you're nuts to swim in the Pongola, you're nuts to swim in the Zambezi. My statistics tell you, and they're like, it's my magic tooth, I'm good. Or in Zambia, there's all sorts of stuff around. That crocodile was sent. That guy had it coming. Yeah, successful at business. We know why, because he's, you know, and now, you know, he's got his, you know, got his just desserts. That crocodile took him out. Oh boy, how do you come back on that one? That's a tough one. And how do people describe their feelings about these events and the aftermath? Met a guy who's a very tough guy, corporal, works in Amphalosi Game Reserve. He's got the sweats, he wakes up, he can't sleep. He was actually charged, picked up by an elephant and thrown. Tough guy, he's never had any problems in his life. He's really shook up. and there's no one's dealing with it, and they're not sure what to do. He's just waiting for it to go away. But we need to factor in that kind of stuff. And you can read entire theses and papers and have discussions about events which are the stuff I talk about, crocodile attacks, and no one will use one word about emotions. It's a massive traumatic impact for people. Okay, we need to figure out how to talk about that. And what stories do we tell about this stuff? We tell stories, they tell stories. There are different stories going on about what's going on. And the thing I'm trying to get to here with the conflict is, how do we communicate across these different borders? Or how do we fail to? I mean, in business, this is well known. If you want to do international business, you've got to figure out, now, how do I speak to people from, the businessmen from Japan about this? How do they run meetings? It's very different. You know, if someone's reticent in a meeting, does that mean you should fill up that space? Like, if you're American, you might just think, well, I'm going to talk a lot. If you're Japanese, it's just rude. There are different ways of running these things. You all know, if you've worked in African societies, you go and meet the chief, whatever, you keep below the heart of the person, you wait to be spoken to. There are different ways of doing things. We need to pay more attention to those styles of communication so that we can start to talk to each other. So what do you do in narrative analysis? You try and investigate storytelling and productions, whether it's songs or those sort of dances. You look at the content of it and the structure of it. You're not interested in the truth necessarily of those stories. You're looking to how and why people are telling these stories. Why are they telling a story about this thing? What are they trying to achieve with it? You work together with the person. You're not objective or outside. You work together and you try and work out a detailed account of what's going on, not a general statement, not a brief answer. And the point about this is it's not the way we tend to do this. It's a case-based approach. It's not a variable-centered approach. And so far, we've gone for the variable-centered approach. What are the variables, and how do we model them, and how can that explain behavior? This is more case studies. The case study is well-established within law. It's well-established within medicine. You might recognize this fellow. Normally, you see him with a big beard. This is him rather young. And what I want to say about that is that the inference in this kind of approach is not about generalizing from a sample to the entire population, which is what we tend to do. Rather, it's generalization to theoretical propositions, which might be transferable. And in the meantime, you're learning a lot about specification. Essentially, you can argue this is what Darwin did. All these examples, and he generalized, he came up with a theory of a fairly well-known theory. Sigmund Freud did similar, although he's somewhat less respectable than some circles. So briefly, grounded theory is can be very useful if you have time and if you want to go into a place and try as much as possible to be open to what's going on in that place and put, as far as possible, preconceptions aside. So that's the classic Strauss and Corbin summary of how you do it. You try to minimize your preconceptions as much as possible. You're trying to let the data generate the theory rather than going in with your preconceptions and frameworks. And incidentally, if you're doing coding, Vivo is great. Manual coding is a nightmare. It's done regularly. Really hard work. I know, done it. That's lovely. Just drag and drop. Very good. And the best thing about it is that when we use qualitative data, one of the major problems you have is it's never referenced properly. It doesn't appear in the results except as unattributed, well, quotations. Sorry, big sigh. If you're presenting, collecting quantitative data, you're required to present it in your results. Tends to happen with qualitative data is it only shows up in the discussion. Why? Because you don't record it in a systematic way. It needs to be, the whole point in science and social science equally is it needs to be replicable, your method. right? So somebody, if you have done coding, somebody needs to be able to go back and look at your documents and see if your coding is plausible, at least in theory. Good luck to help, you know, in all science, there's not enough people checking with stuff, but if you're capturing qualitative data, you need to have a system. Save it in a standard way, name it in a standard way, have line numbers. When you quote, quote precisely. Give a line number. Interview, if you, you know, the anonymized, interview blah blah on this day, line 53. Because then I can check, I can call you out, I can say, well, I want to see that transcript. I could check. I could check. We use qualitative data too loosely. Just quoting a and other person, it's not rigorous enough, and it should be. So I work with, as an environmental historian and a historical ecologist, different kinds of evidence, and this is what we do in a sense. We try and study how the physical, biophysical world shapes human history and how we understand and shape the natural world through time. And we triangulate between a variety of sources. There's an awful lot of what's going on in any conservation situation, particularly in situations where there's been colonial and all sorts of other post-colonial shenanigans, that is shaped by past relationships, and you just need to know what those are. To find out what those are, there are professional people who do that, right? History is harder. It's hard, actually. If you say you're doing history, you can refer to history, or you can say there's some context. But if you're saying you're doing history, best you talk to a historian, or you go and do a lot of reading, a lot more reading than you plan, probably. Because you cannot say you've done history and you have no primary sources. Yeah, there are all kinds of things you expect it to do. So, I think history is informative. I'm not going to say anything more about it, but these are some of the other ways that we can draw on to help us get to this elusive thing. Finally, and this is, I'm just being slightly provocative, wildness. Lots of stuff about wilderness, not a lot of stuff about wildness, and I think an issue we have is that we don't really like to study animals that aren't wild. We're conservationists, right? We want to study wild animals. The problem is, a lot of the animals that are causing the problems are in interaction with people. In fact, an African Indian for millions of years actually would be living around each other to varying degrees of interaction. But this is called habituation, and we don't like to study it. Well, if we're doing conflict, we need to study it. So, and I think for this reason we haven't developed methods for studying the relationships between humans, domestic animals, and wild animals in shared landscapes. And there's interesting work here. I mean, I think some of the stuff Andy's been doing in collaring livestock and how they move around and how lions behave around them. They behave differently when they're hunting wild animals, differently when they're behaving livestock. I mean, that's really cool stuff. But this is a different way of thinking about animals in relation with people. Biologists tend to study the animals and anthropologists study the people, but actually how about thinking of a community of interacting people and animals in particular places? And why is it difficult? Well, there's a lot of animal research coming out, some of it's questionable grasp, but there's a lot of interesting stuff on the individual behavior of animals. If you think that animals are individuals, maybe they have individual biographies. If an elephant or a hippo is being bothered and hassled, it might behave in ways which are not typical when you come across them. Social groups, heaven forfend, the same species might behave differently. So there's this knowledge of culture. What do we mean by that? Well, killer whales have their own languages. Culture, in the sense, is just learned behavior passed on to your children. So, there might be particular more than human communities. I hate that phrase. What does it mean? It just means that in particular places, humans and certain animals have learned to behave around each other in a particular way, which is not typical. If you look at, I've published on this across Africa, people have very different relationships with crocodiles in different places. Something going on there, but we don't study that. We study them separately, so we don't really get to what's going on. So there's a whole bunch of people in animal studies. I find this a very difficult field. There's a lot of jargon, there's a lot of nonsense. So there are a few people in there who say really interesting things. So here's getting back to this issue of anecdotes, describing singular animals, things doing unusual things. We need this, we use this kind of evidence, anecdotal and evidentiary forms, which actually in terms of scientific practice, we tend to dismiss as one. So it's the stuff, you go to the conference, you present all your results, and at the bar, you're having a beer, people tell you, you won't believe what this lion did. Doesn't make it into the paper, doesn't make it into the journal, the lion did it, something's going on. So what's the take home? From what I'm saying today, humans are primarily rational. In my sphere of interest, we should ask, why don't people take on perfectly sensible mitigation? Why not? We should be more curious. We tend to just say they're fatalists or they're idiots. They might both be true, but there might be all sorts of other reasons why not. So we need to understand all these other things beyond attitudes. Attitudes are important, but there's a whole bunch of things that inhibit or encourage people's behavior. We don't really have the best methods and conceptual frameworks for dealing with some of this stuff. And there are other people who do. And we can find them and talk to them. Talk to Kate. She's just over there. It's hard to generalize from particular social ecological situations to others. And often the problem there is it's the cultural stuff that's messing us up when we're trying to generalize. Even crocodiles are much more intelligent than we think. Don't even start enough to talk for a long time about crocodiles, but they're intelligent, they adapt to, they interact with people in different ways in different contexts. You've got to factor that in when you're trying to intervene in a particular place. And really, finally, I suppose, just because something isn't true doesn't mean it doesn't matter. That applies to traditional beliefs, but it also, particularly as we found recently, applies to media stories. They can really, really matter. Even though they're nonsense. And finally, just to echo something Steve said, we need to accept we're players. We're not outside it. We're in it. We're a very important part of it. We're in our corner, but there are a lot of other players involved, and we need to think about how we need to always factor ourselves in and our need and our values when we're trying to sort out the larger picture. And that's it.
Both, and I should thank you for making 11 air trips to get here.
Yeah.
That's. I think now there's a bit of time for general discussion, and I want to say to both of you, in a way that's probably unsurprising and certainly not diminishing, I think much of your core principle messages here are ones where it's a particular community you're pushing, what I describe amiably as an open door. I think the notion of what you might call open-minded discussion and awareness of other people's position is one that's practically and professionally very familiar and adopted by almost everybody in this room. It occurs to me, just thinking back, that I think it was in about 2000 that I was invited to write an essay on a new charity Balance Trust UK, about what seemed to me to be important about the future of conservation. Mm. And I coined a term then, which just came to me when Steve was talking, which was that I called future laying respectful engagement. Mm. Respectful engagement between people and nature, and between different sorts of people when they were discussing people and nature. And those two words seemed to me to capture a little bit of what we were talking about. And
yeah.
So as I said, similar view. Anyway, time is racing away from us. We're having such fun, but I think there's a few moments for general discussion. And I know both of you have other meetings and things to have this morning. Any questions?
This was just a very precise question to do with the picture you showed of the people swimming or paddling in the river, where it specifically says this is a nasty place where crocodiles and hippos. was going to get attention. Why do you think that is?
So it's a good one. I have often speculated about it. One of the reasons might be people really don't like being told what to do. And those signs are symbols of authority. They're always put up by the parks board or people like that. I wonder whether it wouldn't be much more effective to just put a sign up, a little map, put on some photographs of the people who've been killed, put a date, and you could even have one of the little circle where you can put your head through and write who's next. And then it's your, here's the information, you make your call. These things happened here. But if you have a sign, certainly young men, I mean Northern Territory, that fellow who was killed very recently, Woodford, whatever he's called, who went to the gator hole and the sign said, "No swimming gators." And his famous last words were, "If the gators jumped in and landed more or less on top of the large gator, which probably killed him." Well, Darwin Award right there. But yeah, why? But I think also it's because it happens very seldom. And people just think, well, it won't happen.
Yeah. So probability. If we've got time, I just have two thoughts I want to share. One is that I think when it comes to, at least my perception of crocodile attacks, it's kind of like a car accident. I mean, you know, cars are really dangerous. Mm. Most people drive. Terrible, awful injuries happen.
Yeah.
It's part of life. And the ugly side to that benefit is the hideous risk.
Yeah.
So that's just a, you know, that's
calculation
the only
explanation
for just getting on and jumping in the river because, you know, you take chances, you pay your money, you take a chance kind of thing.
Yeah.
But, you know, you mentioned Zambia. In my experience of 4 meter horrible, scary crocodiles in the rivers in Zambia, the guys do not jump in the water.
No.
You know, I mean, people have a reverence that's, don't go in there, it's horrible.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's plenty of sensible examples where people understand and have their own methods for saying, you know, I understand the risks, I'm not prepared to take it, or there are occasions where I might because I'm pushed in a direction. But then you have the crazy picture of the beach, you know, the kind of, they don't really know.
Can I just interrupt? I mean, I thought one of the, when I was down at Cape Town, one of the things that strikes you, you have all these shark spotters.
Yes.
And so people kind of, you know, they sound the alarm, so there's a, you know, 3 meter great white in the water there, suggests you come out, everyone comes out. Apart from the surface, you go, great.
Yeah.
Because they're showing off, because it's a peacock's tail.
Right.
You know, they want to show their
cool
and they're able to deal with the risk. And so it's an important part of the surfing culture to be able to go out and do that.
Just
you go, there's just there.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Mm-hmm. That British fellow got eaten.
Yeah.
And he was told.
Yeah.
He was told.
All the businesses are concerned about it because it damages their.
But they made a choice, though. That was their personal choice.
Okay, well, I'm going to direct this at Steve actually because it comes down to what you were saying earlier on, sorry. And quoting you correctly, when you were talking about conservation conflict, you say, what are we trying to do? So, two questions really. Who is we? And so that goes on to this, who are we? You doing this for, and linking it to the ideas of transparency. Because I think that's probably quite an important.
I mean, I think that's what I was trying to get at. How do you see yourself? How do you position? How do we all position ourselves in this place?
But when we use, or when somebody uses the term "we" in conservation, who do they mean? Are they referring to like-minded people themselves, other conservationists?
Mm.
Are they thinking about different groups? That's something I think.
Mm.
When I started to talk, I listened to myself and I go, well, there he goes again. That's we conservationists. And that's what I was talking about, you know, this tension of conservation science. Am I a conservationist or am I trying to join my friends? And how do I. It's easy to switch between one and the other, and it's really confusing and difficult. So you have to constantly.
Just listening to Steve a while ago, actually, it said something really helpful in this respect, because I was at a meeting of geographers, and Bill Adams was there, and he said, oh, I'm not conservationist, I write about conservation. That's an uncritical position to be. And I thought, well, and everyone was saying, oh no, you're not conservationist. And I said, well, no, I am, because I want there to be crocodiles in the wild. And now I fully accept that there's a lot of problems with that, which I fully want to engage with. And I don't want people to be bitten by crocodiles. And I'm trying to make some feeble efforts in that general direction. But it's important that I say, that's what I'm trying to do. And so I was in this situation at Ndungu doing this workshop. And I was thinking, I was telling them that Crocodile Conservation South Africa started here. And you know, I showed my dad at the restocking thing, and Philemon Mthethwa and Ben Gomed and Mizia and all these guys, local guys, and it turned out the cook was Philemon's daughter and was really nice, and she said, no, that's my dad. But it occurred to me halfway through that these guys were there complaining about the damn crocodiles. And I thought, hang on a minute. You know, my father was the fool who made sure there still are crocodiles here. You know, so you know, it didn't come up as an issue, but I kind of paused to reflect on what we were trying to achieve from the conservation point of view, and the consequences for these guys are pretty different.
I just wanted to add on to what John was asking, the question why people will ignore a sign that's well written to say the crocodiles here should be swimming.
Yeah.
As you showed in your presentation. I just wanted to give a similar example like we find in Zimbabwe, where we're monitoring lines that are colored, we know where they are, and we send a message to the communities to say, their lines had your livestock or bring them home, something like that.
Yeah.
And then you go out just to have a look if people did get your message.
Yeah.
They got the message, but they're just leaving their cattle to graze unattended. And you ask yourself, what is happening? One thing that we're finding is people, they're not behaving irrational, like you correctly said. People are making decisions in the back of their head. They're making calculations.
Yes.
They're looking at the probability of their cows getting eaten. So maybe in your case, it could be looking at the probability of when someone's going to be attacked by a crocodile. If it's less compared to the benefit they're going to get by playing in the water, for example, if swimming makes them feel much better, they make those decisions, they make those calculations,
yes.
And then if the benefit of swimming is far much greater than the risk of losing your life to a crocodile, they're going to ignore your signs and continue doing
So from your transfer, I think one of the most fascinating things that you're finding out, and this is what you need to write, and reading Guy's thesis, is they might seem irrational, but there are actually processes of decision making going on, which it's super important for us to understand. That is incredibly useful knowledge if we're trying to understand that system. So capture that knowledge rigorously so that you can share it, because it's there are calculations, and I think as Dortmund's saying, you make calculations about risk. People, is it really worth building a big enclosure? Because there might be one crocodile attack. And then, being in Africa a month later, the river's over there, and you have to maintain it, and maybe it's just not worth the calculation.
I think it's really similar to choosing to live in New York City or driving your car fast. I think, people from everywhere, every one of us is first and foremost a human with a human brain that does the same stuff as everybody else's brain. So, as an individual, you make a decision about everything you do. Some of it's conscious, some of it's sort of feels automatic, but it's a judgment, And I think those living in some remote areas in the bush is frightening and dangerous, but it's pretty frightening and dangerous to be walking through a street at night in London or New York.
I'm living in a very polluted big city.
Yeah.
My daughter's, I'm a bit worried she's got. She gets a bit short of breath, and sometimes I think, what am I doing?
Yeah.
Thanks for you.
I just want to comment on the who are we issue, and we need to capture this because we're writing some guidelines right now on how the role that a conservation person takes in these conflicts. And I tend to think that this concept of we and whether
or not is a constantly fluid kind of position. There's some sort of identity, there's these values that are quite stable, but then you shift into different roles all the time. So if you spend time with cattle ranchers, a lot of them will say, well, we're conservationists. We protect the environment, we're part of the environment. They might shoot the animal they are trying to preserve, but they genuinely feel that they are pro-conservation. And so that is a perfectly valid identity that they affiliate with. On the other hand, I, as a conservation scientist in my profession, have to sometimes mediate a situation where I have to accept that killing the species is an option, it's a valid option, and I'm open to discussing it and doing that right now with a situation with bats in Mauritius. And so I think we can describe it a little bit in that way, that this we is a fluid concept, and it's all about that when we're working in this realm to just have quite careful awareness of the implications and openness to that other people might see themselves as for conservation too.
Also perhaps in terms of statements, when it's sort of made as we as conservation scientists, there is an element of imposition on other groups without any apparent interaction with them and understanding or probing their perspectives, which and that's one of the things I wanted to actually get at, that conservation is a form of cultural imperialism in some ways. Or it can be seen in that way, and lots of people have written about it in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And the use of language and the who is included in which groups,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's come up in teaching groups of students from a range of places. We're actually, this West African student years ago, masters, suddenly stood up and challenged one of the classmates and said, okay, when you talk about we, do you mean only middle class white people from Western countries? Or do you include me in that as a West African who's been educated in your system but comes from outside?
Mm.
And I thought it was, I was delighted with this response. But I think those are things we actually have to think more about as well.
And I might, without being too frivolous, say there's people in the room who've survived the experience of being my graduate student or a cohort of things. All those people will tell you the ferocity with which I expunge the word we from anything we write.
Mm-hmm.
Because to me it's an impolite presumptuousness to assume that anybody else necessarily is the same as me in my expressing opinion. So
mm-hmm.
I hope you don't find many we's in our publications. But anyway, the clock is ticking ferociously. But I just wanted to ask Steve one question, if I might. And Steve, I think you'll know the spirit in which I ask it, but just in case anybody misunderstands you, you made an allusion to a paper that we wrote recently with John Vucetich, who sadly just missed, he was here until recently. And it was under a slide where you said it was something about fear, and it was something you said you didn't buy, and then you had a quote from a paper in Time and yourself had written. So I didn't quite understand what it was you didn't buy, but let me say, if anybody misunderstands, I asked that with purely a spirit of inquiry. If we hold different views, which I rather doubt, but if we do, then there's no prickliness in that. So it's interesting.
No, that's fine. Like we've discussed, you know, we have really challenging issues, and we have to figure out how we're going to have some ways through this. I mean, it was this idea that if you except people have different views and attitudes and values, then it becomes this more of a sort of equivalency of the arguments.
Mm.
There's no, you know, you can't move forward, you just get trapped in this stuff. And like Simon and I tried to write, you know, we think that's not necessarily true. You can explore those different arguments and different positions and still be able to move forward and analyse and discuss those positions.
Well, then, now isn't the moment that we have a long trip. I have the same sense after hearing what you said there as I did when I saw the quotations, and that is that we actually share the same opinion. And so I'll quickly try to capture that. As you said, with considerable scholarship, you know, we're all interested in everybody in this room, at least not everybody outside, is interested in evidence, scientific evaluation. But as we look at the landscape of evidence, I'm fond of
seeks to do is to whittle away stuff that is confusing or masking or fuzzy to find out really what is the evidence, but at the end of the day, to make an evaluation of what facts are on the basis of the best available evidence, but that takes you from evidence and science into making judgments about what to do. And a lot of the work you've discussed this morning, I think, is about making judgments and hoping that these judgments are wise, wisdom being a scarce resource. So what I think we were saying in the quotation that, that you showed was that there may come a point at a moment in time when you run out of evidence to resolve differences between people. There may come a point, nobody exhaustive the evidence is, when it's not going to help you make a difficult decision. And people may then hold different opinions. These different opinions may come from different values. People do have different values, and that is not to say that they're necessarily right or wrong, because people are different. And so I think what we were trying to say is that there's a point where there may be differences of opinion, and it was in the context of saying, are there then principles that would help us evaluate how to go forward when we face such differences? And the sort of principles that I think we had in mind when we wrote that paper, I think resonate very closely with what both of you said, and it's taking account, as far as one can, the positions of different people. And we push it a little further to say that that some of the wildlife musicians also are stakeholders. They're not merely chips in bankers' game. That was perhaps the originality, if I can call it that, of what we're trying to say. So I just want to say, not that it's a problem if we take a different opinion, but I don't think, from what you said, we are. I think we're seeing a landscape from slightly different hilltops and expressing different parts of it.
I mean, there's a lot to discuss, and there we can go on all day, but I mean, I think what I would argue is we're not necessarily very good at saying, so take me to your hilltop. Obviously, that's why I couldn't agree more. And here's my answer. Come over and have a look at this. And you come up with different hypotheses about how the world works. And then you explore that together. And say, okay, what do you think? You're from your health, but that's my health. What's going on? How can we explore that area together?
And I think there's perfect resonance between our views on that. So, anyway, look at this.